Welcome back to Cinema Sit Down. Today we watched Boat People. It was about a Japanese photographer who was sympathetic to the communist cause in Vietnam, whenever the war was going on. But the film takes place many years later, after the war is ended, where the photographer goes through the country on a press tour. The government shows him a lot of places, but eventually he decides to break off on his own and take pictures of the city and the citizens in a more candid way. And that is where our story really starts. But before we get into that, I'm going to introduce my guest for today, starting with right over here.
I'm Brendan Barnes. Thank you for having me. We're going to talk about boats and people.
Presumably. Next.
I'm Alexis. I truly don't know that much about this film.
Well, this seems like a very promising cast of cohorts. All right, so to get started, we'll go over the story just a little bit. So obviously, this movie has a lot of themes, a lot that it's trying to say, and it's extremely, extremely political, especially for the time. It was, as you said, viewed as a sort of anti-communist movie, especially since it was made in Hong Kong, that caused a lot of controversy. So what were your own opinions on the movie, on its politicalness? What did you interpret from that?
Well, heavily political, in there is communist memorabilia found all throughout the film. Post-war, because of all the minefields and all the essentially war-torn and ravaged areas that half of the main cast live in. I will say that going into this film, I didn't know what to expect, but it took a lot of like dark and it's a hard film to digest, honestly.
Yeah, it is, but that does bring me to one of my favorite aspects of the movie, and how it's sort of presented in a way where the movie sort of changes its own tone, its own feeling, its own color palette, based on how far we into the story. So the main character, the photographer, is sort of an insert for the viewer, learning about, you know, the realities of the Vietnamese government post-war after they won the war. So the movie takes a shift in tone from, you know, a very bright, happy place. The movie starts off with children singing in one of the Vietnamese new economic zones, which is what they're harboring as, you know, places of economic development where family and children can thrive and find jobs and work. And we start off with a group of singing children. It's all very bright. It's all very happy. But as we go on, the movie gets darker and darker, and we are, as we're brought into the more back corners of Vietnam that, you know, the government officials don't necessarily want us to see or didn't want the photographer to see. It gets so much darker. It gets, of course, the color red is such a big theme in this movie. And it just overall gets more bloody every time we see a character's death on screen. So the movie has such a great progression that way. Did you have any thoughts about the story overall?
I don't know. I don't like blood or gore in any sense, usually in movies anymore, because I just physically like can't handle it. So sometimes seeing some of the stuff come up on screen, I was like, oh, that makes me like sick to my stomach. I think overall, like, the story has a really interesting like thing to say, like what they're trying to portray and talk about. Because they say in the beginning, like, he thinks it's a very like happy-go-lucky country, like everybody's bright, very singing, and he slowly finds out like the truth more and more, because I guess you could say he's like a photojournalist, because he's constantly taking photos with a beautiful camera, by the way. Love that Nikon. I think the way that they portray it and the way that they kind of show it throughout is done really well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So after the protagonist, he asked the I forget what her official title is, but she's the one showing the photographer around the city. After he asks her to be let go of his leash, to be given a candid look at all of Vietnam,
The cultural liaison.
The cultural liaison. So after he is sort of granted that permission, we get to meet the family, which is one of the other, I guess, main characters in the movie, the family unit. Again, the names are all in Vietnamese, so I couldn't tell you what they were.
We do not want to butcher these names.
It's okay.
And we would.
Nobody's going to blame you.
But for the most part, they call each other sister, first brother, second brother, and mother for the majority of the movie, which is, it's just what their names are for each other. And this is sort of our first candid look at what life is actually like in post-war Vietnam, what this Maoism has actually done to this country, and not just what the, you know, propagandists are trying to show us. And we get a very dark look at the actual economic opportunities which are brought on by the communist Maoist regime, which is now running the place. We see people doing pretty much everything for money.
Yeah.
Sort of degrading themselves, but we also see the government constantly coming in and rounding people up.
Yeah. Any able-bodied man.
There's a scene in the market early on where one of the characters says they're taking any able-bodied man to take them to a new economic zone. And that's sort of the first time that our main character realizes that these new economic zones might not be places where people actually want to go because the government is rounding them up.
Yeah.
So at that point in the movie, it starts off with this more propagandistic look at Vietnam. At what point did you guys sort of start to see where the movie was actually going, and sort of what was your reaction to that?
So after the gold paint started to flake, as a way to put that, that was the chicken coop scene where they were literally pulling, trying to loot the dead bodies of
small
people.
Children.
Yeah. And it wasn't the fact that they were doing it so much as like their reaction, or it was just like another day to them. Mm-hmm. It was such a natural thing. It's just like it didn't even faze them. The kids were like posing, like, take a picture of me over this dead body. Yeah. It's like, yeah. And of course the photographer, being a photojournalist, wanted to take more candid photos of the two people carrying the one body into the cart.
Yeah. And to them it's just another avenue for making money, another dish to put on the table, and for them it's more of a happy event. Every time we hear gunshots off, we can see first brother running off to say, hey, it's time to go to the chicken coop again.
Yeah.
It's an exciting time for these young kids who are going to loot dead bodies.
Yeah.
Did you have one of those moments where the movie sort of surprised you, like, oh, this is what the movie's about?
The one I remember visibly the most is the market scene, because she's like pulling him through and trying to make sure like he doesn't get taken away by them or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like, and she hides him in the entryway of this house or whatever. She's just standing by the door. I mean, you could see it, but she's just standing by the door, and you can see like all of them are like a bloodied mess. Like, some of them are trying to fight them off. I mean, she gets pushed into fruit or vegetables or whatever.
They're loading people into these trucks,
like,
and putting bags over them.
Yeah, they don't. Yeah. They have no regards for the people.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's, I guess, sort of also one of the journalist's first looks into how the government is actually treating its people. It's the people that they fought for, the people that they fought for equality for, and how they're now using those people for to take to their new economic zones or their slave labor camps.
Yeah.
Bouncing off first brother's death. There are a lot of character deaths in this movie. In fact, all but two characters die. But one thing that's very noticeable, at least to me in the movie, is how quick they all are. Each character's death only really gets lingered on for a few seconds to a minute, if that.
Yeah.
Very few tears are shed over them before we move on to the next scene in the movie. What's your guys' take on that?
I feel like that's like the reality of what's going on. Like, you know that there's a lot of struggle and anger within the people, and they don't necessarily care about them. So they go, oh, it's a death. Okay, well, whatever, let's move on. Like, we don't really care about you.
So you'd say it's more what the government is thinking.
Yeah.
It's one of the government's point of view is that they're disposable.
Yeah.
First off, I want to say that first brother's death was absolutely horrifying. Like
it comes out of nowhere.
I know, and like it was the first like major death of the movie, and I was not expecting it because he was definitely one of my favorite characters. He had the most spunk. Mm-hmm. He was like the coolest.
He was just a little kid full of life.
You know? And like he really was innocence, mm-hmm. and his death symbolizes the death of innocence. Mm-hmm. That's when the movie started like spiraling down into all the darker realms that it treads. But in regard to your question about the quick deaths, I actually agree a lot with what Alexis said. Mm-hmm. About it's just a death is just a moment in time, and they don't have the time to linger. So through the perspective of the government, yeah, they are not important, but through the perspective of the people, they can't mourn. Honestly, the only death they mourn more or mourn for the longest would probably be the mother's mm-hmm. death. And that's only because what it symbolizes later in the movie, and that's the separation mm-hmm. of the family.
Yeah, I agree with that a lot. I took it more the more humanistic route, where it's more representative of the people and how much time they have to linger on it. Of course, one of the other characters in the movie, he's just shot on a boat by pirates, and we see him lay dead there a few seconds, and then he's never mentioned again because nobody necessarily knew that he died. To them, he just went to a new economic zone and never came back. But yeah, it's just every time there is a death in the movie, we immediately move on to what the characters are doing next. Life is going on for them, and sometimes life changes because of that, sometimes it doesn't. But at the end, they just don't have time. They need to be getting back out there. They need to continue to make money to try to live in this authoritarian government where there are no job opportunities. So I guess to talk about the title of the movie a bit, Boat People, because it doesn't explicitly get explained in the movie. The title itself refers to sort of the waves of Vietnamese people that were fleeing from, I suppose they were refugees that were fleeing from Vietnam to wherever else in the world, and they all arrived on these boats packed people on top of people. You can see at the end of the movie that everyone is packed together so tightly. So the boat people refers to, the refugees that arrive on those boats escaping from Vietnam, escaping that authoritarian government. And at the very end, we see sister and second brother escaping on the boat, but notably they leave behind the journalist who burns to death, and maybe the truth along with that. So yeah. I'm interested to know, because again, the photographer's death is extremely, extremely sudden. And it almost seems purposeless. And we can only assume that from his death that the truth, all of his pictures, went along with him.
Yeah.
So there's a lot to take away from that. Do you guys think that the movie is taking a, individualistic take where it's more important that the photographer is focusing on these individual people? Or would you say that it would have been more important for him to sort of expose the truth of what's happening in Vietnam to a wider amount of people?
Well, since the film focused so heavily on the family, I was hoping at least one of them would make it. So I came to the realization that the photojournalist would probably sacrifice his life's work and his life for them when he sold his camera. For their tickets, because at that point he's resigning any ties he had to the government. He's resigning any work that he had already done to save these two people, because honestly it's because he thought that that's all he can do by doing it. Mm-hmm. Like that's within his power, because he may have even realized by that point there was no way that the government was just going to let him show those photos. Like as soon as he got on the boat, they probably would have been confiscated or sequestered and sorted through and here, you can show these photos. Mm-hmm. So they would have definitely been really picky and choosy about what is actually shown. So, and with the two people surviving, it's two stories of people who lived through this, which can almost be more impactful against that, the government.
Would you take a similar sort of take, Alexis?
Yeah, I think either way, the government would have only shown, like, the happy-go-lucky photos, the children singing. Like, I mean, like, nobody wants to show the raw truth of, like, what they're actually doing, because they're the ones making it happen. So why would they want somebody to uncover that for it to be shown to everybody?
I took it as, going back to how I believe the photographer was a sort of insert for the audience, as he, you know, sort of goes in with the nut with, or assuming that everything was pretty great after the war, he was a big supporter of the Vietnamese in that case. But at the end of the movie, after he is exposed to all these horrors of the new economic zones, of the regular living conditions of the city people, that he instead chooses to do everything he can to save as, you know, as many people as he could, which unfortunately was only two of them. But he sort of did everything he could to save these people's lives. And I almost feel like the filmmaker was encouraging others to do the same, not necessarily in Vietnam, but in some of these other countries which have sort of been depressed by these authoritarian governments, you know, think about these people, help these people. So I almost have to think that the filmmaker was wanting us to sort of take an example from him, not necessarily we have to sacrifice some lives, but that we should take a more humanitarian take at these matters. And
if we help one person, that's one less person being put through that kind of persecution.
Exactly. I think we are getting a little low on time, so I think we should move on to our final thoughts. We can start.
I'll start. Final thoughts. This was a fantastic film. I love the color palettes. Really earthy, really dark, except for the red, as we were talking. Ultimately, this is not a film that I would visit over and over, because I think I'd slowly start to lose my faith in humanity. But in terms of just a raw film, it's fantastic.
Alexis?
Yeah, I definitely think I need to watch this movie more. Maybe I'll watch it again. I don't know if I'll be able to physically handle that, but I don't necessarily think it was a bad film. I did love the color palettes. I'm a sucker for a movie with a strong color palette, though.
This is my third time, I believe, seeing the movie, and I love it a little bit more every time. My faith in humanity was lost a long time ago, so I don't have to worry too much about that. But we didn't even get into the cinematography of this movie, which is just breathtaking so many times over and over. The director, I believe her name was An Hoai, who was really one of the instigators of the Hong Kong New Wave movement, which this movie was a part of. She just did a fantastic job. Everyone on the movie did a fantastic job. The colors, so much symbolism, such a great story that is deeply impactful, as if we come into no other conclusions.
Sound design was really good, too.
It was decent. So well, some, a lot of
the minefield was so tense,
there's a strong use of no sound.
Yeah.
At so many points in the movie, it's very quiet.
Which is a big part of sound design.
Yes. But yeah, this is one of my favorite films. I give it a personal 9 out of 10. I think that is it, though, for the Cinema Sit Down. Thank everybody for joining us. These have been my guests, Brendan and Alexis. We'll see y'all in the next time. Deuces.